Some other kind of non-specific tests, mainly when you're faced with a case. And then treatment. There's no standard treatment. Aggressive supportive treatment is essential. These animals have to be on fluids. They have to be on these very potent antiviral drugs. Some people are using oxygen or blood transfusions. And there are two very excellent protocols, one written by the group in Houston, and then there's another group out of the UK. And this is the kind of information that we have on our website. So these, you can go to Elephant Care International, to the professional content, and you can download these guidelines. We've also developed a more simplified guideline for Nepal, because some of the things that are recommended in these, just the resources aren't available or the equipment to do some of those things. It really is a good idea to start training calves as early as possible. The mahouts need to teach the elephants to open their mouths. At the first sign that this disease might be happening, it is the best time when they might actually survive. So if they can monitor them daily, looking at the health of their mouth, teach them to allow blood to be drawn earlier, then if the disease does hit them, they've got a better chance of survival. A lot of research needs to be done. Again, the virus hasn't been isolated. Once it's isolated, there's a possibility a vaccine could be developed. We need some better information on treatment as well. That was 20 minutes. Do you want me to do anything on feet?
No.
Okay.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, I apologize because since I could not come first session. And now I have seen this Balipara Foundation myself taken all the necessary care, or those who are coming from outside as well as from India. I, on behalf of Forest Department, I welcome all the guests, all the eminent specialists of this Balipara Foundation, this on the issue of elephant, whether it is domestic or wildlife, wild. I would like to mention here that, in Assam, we have more than 5,000 elephant wild, and more than 1,300 elephant domestic. Our main concern at present is the man-elephant conflict. This is very serious. Earlier, it used to be only in the winter when the paddy crops during the time of harvest. Now it is almost 365 days. Either elephant is killed or man is killed, alternate day. So this is a serious matter for us. So I hope that with this meeting, something concrete will come where this man-elephant conflict will be reduced, and we can happily coexist, and department can work happily also and without any tension in the field. At present, I can say that all our state government is concerned about only this man-elephant conflict. We are not concerned about anything except this man-elephant conflict, because every day we are, we will see in the TV always, yes, last night also, our forest personnel also manhandled because we could not tackle this depredation. So I hope with this Balipara Foundation will come out something good and concrete solution about this man-elephant conflict. Thank you very much.
We are delivering on various issues. Human-elephant conflict is definitely at the top of the agenda. So this half actually was dedicated to the captive elephants and their problems. So basically, we are also discussing about the captive elephants, their welfare, and their health issues like that. So after lunch, we'll go back to the main venue. And all those issues will be taken. 2 days program is here. So definitely there will be some good suggestion, and all the experts have come here. We are all concerned for elephants as well as for the people. So we want that the conflict should be minimized and everybody should be safe. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So Susan is not left. because that issues, those two issues she has been requested to deliver, that one is the tuberculosis, the other is herpes. So before I ask her again and say, let me, because as the lead veterinarian for elephants from this region, I have to say a few words regarding our experience with these two diseases and some good experience also. What we have learned, that if the elephants can be allowed to live a near natural life, I think the chances or possibility of tuberculosis is much less. Because I have seen the elephants in Nepal, you know, most of these elephants were actually purchased from Assam, legally or illegally, mostly illegally, and there they are living a very constrained life. Most of the elephants do not even have access to green grass whole life, they only get paddy straw. So here Assamese elephant owners, they cannot even believe that, that elephants can live on paddy straw and some concentration. Here, 12 months, our elephants get green grass, abundance of water, and no crowding. Our elephants live a natural life. They go out for grazing. So that kind of, and so I have not done any specific investigation so far as tuberculosis is concerned, but some 10 years back, we have carried out a survey work. And that trunk was our main approach, as well as culturing in microbiology department. So we found out of 86 elephants that we screened, only two were positive. And we treated with the protocol, and one we could save, and it became negative later on. It's still there. One died. And on postmortem, we found she was tuberculosis. Interestingly, these two elephants were very much constrained because of the poverty of the owner. So they were from the same owner, but when we found, they were in two different places. So that also proves that the investigation was okay. The lesson learned from this is that let the elephants live a natural type of life. The stress of tuberculosis will be less, number one. But herpes is giving us sleepless night, I tell you. Because till last 3 years, we didn't have herpes, fortunately. Heidi Riddle is sitting there. She was always warning us, prepare for herpes, establish a lab there. She was ready, Elephant International Elephant Foundation, and they were ready. I said, at least not now. We don't have the herpes problem. If there is any case, I will be the first man to know. We don't have, we don't have. But suddenly, you know, in a very remote corner, I get a phone call in the morning. The owner, it's a privately owned elephant, 2 years age. The owner says, suddenly my elephant calf have become lethargic and head is little bit swollen. Doctor, what it could be? I said, check the tongue. He says, oh, it is purple in color. My God, it's herpes. From where it come? It is totally remote. It's a area called Lanka, not Sri Lanka, Lanka. So, okay, I immediately rushed, but before I, because it is 3 hours drive, I said, start acyclovir, 12.5 milligram per kg body weight, 6 hourly. It's human medicine, you find in any human shop, get the first dose. And the immunomimetic and other anti-stress, I am also coming. I came and I found, yes, I collected sample. And in the meantime, our we have a diagnostic laboratory. Now we have also established PCR for that. So we brought sample. It was confirmed herpes. Now my question was, how did the disease come here? Out of nowhere? Now there is an interesting observation which I want to put forward to the international community. Can a healthy human being, without himself suffering, transmit elephant herpes virus? Can? Nobody probably is thinking about it, because there I saw a linkage. Because when I examine how, from where the disease could have come, there was a guy from Kerala, you know, Arun's place, Arun Chakaria's place. They are having herpes for a couple of years and quite a good number of elephant death because of herpes. That man come from there and he is an elephant trader. He came for looking for some prospective elephant that he can buy. So there, that man was there for 1 month with that elephant. And I asked him, did you handle any herpes elephant? He says, yes, I have attended two post-mortem examination case. He's not a veterinarian, but he was there in an elephant camp in Kerala. He was there. Now, the only connection is that that man was here also. Now, it has to be studied. Can a human spread the disease, spread the virus himself? No, I'm not clear, but I got that information.
I'm director of elephants and conservation activities for a Thai-based hotel firm called Anantara Resorts and Spas. I also run a small elephant camp, captive elephant camp in the far north of Thailand for Anantara, and have a growing foundation based or mainly paid for by a minor hotel group that aims to help elephants, both captive and wild, throughout Southeast Asia. We talked a little bit earlier on about standards and about some of the controversies around elephants in captivity. Luckily, because the suggestions already come up, the talk was here to, I put this talk together to try and enlighten people as to what's happening across in Southeast Asia. You might notice that I put ASEAN, Captive Elephant Working Group, up there. That's actually our old name, but I put it there to remind me that we are an Asian, when we say Asian Captive Elephant Working Group, we're talking about elephants from Asia rather than captive Asian elephants from around the globe. So it's we're still working a little bit on the working a little bit on our title. It's a fairly new enterprise. Our goal, our vision, which we put together about a year ago now, was to create a functional international working group to bring together invested parties in pursuit of creating sustainable life for the captive elephants in Southeast Asia. We've been through captive elephant numbers. I don't know if you know, in Southeast Asia, because of the traditional lack of employment, a lot of the elephants now find themselves either unemployed or needing tourism, needing so-called ecotourism, although it's not always very eco, in order to survive. Lisa also touched on some of the controversies about that, about whether we should be inviting people to come and sit on our elephants and how to work them, where they end up working. Also, of course, from Susan's talk, and we've mentioned this before, a lot of the things about disease control as well. So I would like to say that it was all my idea and that I'd done all the work, but we have a lot of people. I'm actually the most junior person here in the group, so I better tell the truth. It was born of, the idea, I think, for the group was born of Dr. Chacho, or Dr. Bick's work through the Elephant Research and of Excellence Center in Chiang Mai University. For some years, he's been studying the elephant camps around Chiang Mai. And for those of you who don't know, Chiang Mai is one of the hotspots for elephant tourism in Thailand. A lot of the elephants are up there, and before they started migrating down to the beach, it was the hotspot. So for several years, Chiang Mai University have been working very hard on investigating all things from medical to welfare to traditions surrounding elephants. And as time had come up, he was noticing that more and more of the camps were asking how to better look after their elephants. But of course, and we've touched on it already, I'd be lying to you if I said that was the only reason that they were interested. In Thailand, we have come under, and in certain cases, very rightly so, a lot of pressure from people like World Animal Protection, from PETA, about the way elephants are looked after. Now, a lot of the information that these organizations and their fellow people put out are not particularly accurate, but they do have a point, and we do need to try and look at ways to improve the welfare of the elephants we have in captivity. And the working group was put together as, or the idea for the working group came together as a way to address that. Basically, we recognized that whether we were being pressured from outside, from the tourists who are coming in, from everywhere, but also from our own knowledge, that actually we could do a lot better for the captive Asian elephants in Southeast Asia. Gone are the days, it's particularly in Thailand, but also in certain cases in Cambodia, in Malaysia, in Indonesia. We've seen photographs from these places already. Gone are the days that, and it's coming in Myanmar, that the elephants live the lovely life that they do yes, for captive elephants in Myanmar. We can't look after our elephants that well, and certainly a lot of people who have to try and find the vast amount of money that it takes to look after an elephant, be it as a businessman or be it as a mahout, have to find out working their elephant. We also recognize that if we didn't do something about it, we would lose this tradition. They're probably not so much in this room, but there is a lot of debate as to whether we should have elephants in captivity, whether we should continue doing this just for the sake of having the elephants, and ambassadors of the species is a good argument for keeping it that way. Another really valid argument is that wherever elephants are kept in captivity, and KK touched on it earlier, it's part of a very, very old tradition, and certainly within Southeast Asia, and I would say certainly in India and Nepal as well, it's almost part of the soul of the country. The country was built on warfare of elephants. The legend, all the legends contain elephants, 10,000 elephants marching from here to go into a battle. The countries, the principalities, everything were built on elephants. So there is a very valid point that these countries need to have captive elephants as part of their culture. As a group, what have we done? We've met three times, I think three times, maybe four times. Three times. We ate a lot of food, we drank a lot of coffee, we talked a lot, we argued a little bit, not too much. And this is where we might come in for you, not necessarily the first one. We've come up with a statement on elephants in tourism in Southeast Asia. It's one of the reasons I wanted to come out here and present this, is to say that we're not actually, at the moment we're very Southeast Asia based. We've become the Asian Captive Elephant Working Group because we've started to talk to people from Sri Lanka, and we would welcome advice from everybody over here as well. But we're not coming to set up this working group and come over here and tell you guys how to look after your elephants, because we do recognize very strongly that the situations are different, and that the models of tourism that may come in over here probably, hopefully, are not the same as some of the ones we have in Thailand. But we are also here to, certainly from a Thai perspective, let you know about some of the mistakes we've made and how we think you may be able to avoid them. So, I mean, this is a forum. We're all here together, so let's share ideas and let's talk. One of the other things we've come up with, which may be of interest to you guys, is guidelines for camp managers. Now, the reason these came about, first of all, we talked about it from the beginning, and a lot of the, as I said earlier on, a lot of the pressure to set this group up came from camp managers saying, first of all, well, if they're really honest, how can we avoid the criticism? But also, how can we improve the lives of our elephants? So I'm the only elephant tourist person on the entire board. Everybody else is a vet, a scientist, a behaviorologist, a few multidisciplinary people as well, and we helped them put together. Initially, it was going to be a standard, and we have a lot of pressure actually from the tourism side of things, from the tourism industry in Thailand, because as mentioned earlier on, elephant riding, elephant tourism is a really key part of the tour. And then there's a lot of pressure from the aforementioned organizations to try and ban tourism. Nobody yet has come up with an answer as to how these 4,000 elephants we have in Thailand are going to live without tourism. We just don't have any answer for that. But what is also happening, about half the tourism industry, because they don't want to be attacked, have just decided to boycott. We do have tourism operators who've been in Thailand for a very long time, Southeast Asia for a very long time, who've are Thai, and they look around and say, well, we've been doing this for 40 years, we know it's not bad, how do we help point our guests to the camps that are doing good things, and how do we answer the people who are trying to boycott us? And so they asked us to put together a standard. We talked about it and we decided, well, it's actually not our job to help the camps get guests, it's our job to help elephants. So we put together some guidelines, and they haven't passed the editorial board yet, so I can't 100% share them with you, but I think most of the editorial board are here. One of them's not in this room, but he's in the hotel.
Right now.
So we can do that. The statement, to go back to the statement, you can see it's quite once we got the wording right, and there was a lot of back and forth on the wording, as I say, well, it's like trying to decide something in a very large, very expert, multidisciplinary committee, but you'll see the number of people who were involved in the wording and who have endorsed it. So you get some idea of the level of expertise, and actually, I'm not quite sure how I ended up presenting this, because the level of expertise that I'm looking at here is far higher than me. I'm the least expert in all of it. But these are the groups that endorsed, and after a while, once we had them all on board, we actually stopped asking, so I think we could get more endorsements for this if we wanted to. And I can share the statement with you. I didn't print it out because we're a naturenomics conference, and if I started printing stuff and giving out handouts and chopping down trees, Ranjit would probably have had my head. So I can give you a link to the statement, and that's public and that's finalized, and you're welcome to read it. As far as the guidelines, again, there are about 130 general guidelines. Most of them Southeast Asia specific, because that's what we were talking about. Actually, quite heavily Thailand, because that's where the problem currently lies. But they cover all of these topics, and they are not yet comprehensive. And what we were going to do, which we will do sometime, is get together and do, I think there's about 24 other protocols that are going to be more in depth and written by the experts in their field, again, who we have sitting on our committee, which will allow more granular work on it. But with these 130 guidelines, I think we have something that can be taken, it hasn't gone through public review, but it's gone through now expert review, because apart from myself, everybody else in the group's an expert. And it's ready for camp testing. In fact, I have two or three people who want to start camp testing it who want to go, mainly because it's driven by money. The travel agents are losing business because of this. So we're almost ready to start testing it in the camps around Chiang Mai. It's just a question how we do that, and we would hope Dr. Bick's coming for this. I'm going to persuade Dr. Bick while he's here to start going through his center in Chiang Mai University, because it started there and they are the experts. And again, this is a very, very, very quick talk and an introduction, but I'll just finish with the slide I always finish all of my presentations on, because I get to talk about this sort of subject a lot, from conservation and how tourism can help conservation and everything else. But here's my personal belief. We talk a lot about tourism. I know tourism is tourism can certainly answer a question for out-of-work elephants. It can also help, if you do it right, help save wild elephants. But it has to be non-invasive, non-disturbing, and has to benefit the local community. And, of course, has to be non-damaging to the wild population and keep elephant welfare paramount, and try and put in, and I think we covered all of this earlier, try and put some education in there, make them ambassadors for the species. And those are just my personal beliefs. So a very short talk, a very short introduction. I can talk more to people about it later on. Please do come and visit us up in the Golden Triangle. Come and see us on Facebook and everything else. This is all more about me than the working group. I hope I haven't made it too much about me. Yes, thank you very much.
I'm Pankaj Sharma, Senior Wildlife Warden of Assam. I'm posted in the PCCF Wildlife Office. I've served in the department for 30 years. Out of that, about 24 years, I'm serving the wildlife, walking the different parks. As it is said that looking after captive elephants, yes. Each and every protected area, we have captive elephants. I served in Kaziranga for a long duration. The biggest problem we are facing in the Kaziranga, that's the captive elephants. We lost very few of the elephants in recent past, and maximum was due to the liver fluke. We are, thanks to KK Sharma and many of the vets, we are helping us in looking after these elephants. We've faced another problem in long past, that is in 2001, when the government has procured a lot of the elephants through the private captured elephants. And those elephants we faced because the protocol which has been made during that time to capture the elephant above than 6 feet height. So above than 6 feet height, capturing a 6 feet height elephant is not a matter of joke. So The what about the weak elephant? It is possible they captured and handed over to the forest department in 3 months. And then we face the consequences. Because maintaining such a weak elephant and putting in the different work of the forest department, and we lost few of the elephants during that time in 2001 in Namiri National Park. And besides some of the elephants and some of the parks, we maintained the elephant for patrolling during summer as well as in winter. That is exclusively for the rhino bearing areas. And we keep the elephants for the tourism purpose also. So in Kaziranga, we have a high demand of elephant ride. And that's create a lot of problem for us, both in patrolling and the tourism. So I have nothing much to speak. Thank you very much.
He has highlighted on two things. Area-specific diseases within, like, from outside, Assam may look a small space, very small place. But then, Kaziranga National Park, he says, incidence of fasciola that can kill elephants. And in Nameri, he says, number of deaths. Nameri, their elephants are killed by cobalt-deer. The bot fly, cobalt-deer elephants. They can even reach brain as source symptoms. So, interesting, when we know these area-specific diseases, we can take precautionary measures. Can I call upon Dr. Bhaskar Chaudhary? For two things. I have requested him for two things. First is, he has probably the maximum experience of nursing elephant babies. They are rescued from the wild. He has very good experience and that he can share. And also regarding Kutki deployment, I will also call upon Kosundura next, because he has much more experience on deployment of Kutkis in driving wild herds and all that. But I also request Dr. Bhaskar Chaudhary to throw some light on that. But more on nursing of the captive, the wild babies that are orphaned or rescued. Because otherwise, before the Wildlife Trust of India Rescue Center was here, the mortality was very high, but after they started, they have learned, and now the mortality is very low. So we want to hear some of his experience.
Thank you, sir. When we started our project called Center for Wildlife Rehabilitation and Conservation in Assam back in 2000, we had what we have seen over the last 15 years, it's been 15 years now, the number of elephant calves have increased. That is anticipated as you lose more and more forest, and there are issues, complex issues of demography also changing. So especially calf nursing is a very challenging subject. I appreciate throughout the world. I think Suzanne is here, and I think Kain also will agree to it. So the biggest problem we face was formulating a milk formula, and we didn't have any substitute but to use the human infant formula. So what we use is the lactogen 2 formula that the Sri Lankan people also use, that is manufactured by Nestle. We add up a little whey, and we take into consideration the amount of the coconut fat, that is to replace the specific fatty acid in the milk of Asian elephants. So that we have been using for last 4 years, and the mortality has come down. We have unprecedented mortality in 2003, 2004, 2005 that reached up to, I think, 67-72%. But now it is, I don't know whether it is acceptable worldwide or not, we are getting about 40-45% now. And we are also very concerned with the emerging diseases like herpes, as sir has said. We had diagnosed a couple of cases in Kaziranga National Park. One was a captive bone calf. It's a subject that sir has told me I can speak at length, but since time is less, so I think the biggest challenge for nursing a calf is the milk formula and the society, the family that you need. Since this is a social animal, you will need a family to support the psychology of the calf. Sir, that's
I think
let Kaushik Barua deal with Kunki elephants. Now, Kunki, you will know better because you yourself. Okay.
No, I think we should go for coffee.
Yeah.
Okay. Coffee is fine.
Thank you.
Coffee, please.
Thank you very much.
See, human elephant conflict mitigation, we have lots of issues, and we all now recognize that the use of Kunkis are really found to be very useful. And Kosik is one, he himself has Kunkis, and he helped the forest department in engaging Kunkis.
Actually,
so you come here and
join in this program, sitting right next to you. I am the
He'll also speak, but on a different issue, little different. Because we have many issues to just touch.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Kaushik Barwa, and as Dr. Kushal Sharma has asked me to speak about Kunkis. Kunkis is a term synonymous to captive elephants who are trained in the art of elephant capture. So now that, you know, elephant capture is no more there, maybe selective capture in terms of rescue or taking a problem elephant out, but that's on a very small scale. So we have a good number of elephants, male, female, who were used for capture. And now these elephants, the skills of these elephants, which they used to demonstrate while catching wild stock, are now being honed and used to keep wild elephants away from human settlements, agricultural areas, and the likes. Well, over the years, we have used Kunkis very effectively. Unfortunately, our Kunkis are aging too. You just can't take any elephant and, you know, say that this is a Kunki. It takes a certain amount of time, and you need the right people, the right person on top of the elephant to actually man the elephant and do what he's supposed to. Well, Kunkis have been used effectively. I'll give a small example of an area at Deepaurabil. Deepaurabil, the Kunkis were deployed and they've been used effectively. But unfortunately, now the wild herds are somewhat getting immune to it over the years, you know, because elephants are very conditional and adaptive creatures. You know, you keep on exposing them to some sort of mechanism and they adopt to it and they become clever and they go above it, around it, find a new way. Well, it's a band-aid. It's a temporary but effective measure to, you know, mitigate human-elephant conflict to a certain extent, but this is not the ultimate antidote. You know, this is just buying time for more intense conservation actions to come in, and God knows when is that going to come. But yes, we keep on buying time through use of Kunkis. But now, like I've said before, Kunkis are aging, so are the people who are used to, you know, managing and maneuvering Kunkis. So Mr. Pankaj Sharma, he said one thing, that, you know, there is taxation on the forest elephants, on the government elephants, and the park elephants for tourism purpose. So it just gave me an idea. So, you know, they can take their elephants out and we can put private elephants, you know, all elephants can't be Kunkis. So whatever private elephants, few or five private elephants can be, you know, absorb into the tourism industry, it will at least keep these numbers of elephant away from trouble. And in the meantime, you know, if few of the private elephants, smaller elephants, you know, who are just in the sub-adult age, you know, we can put them into a regime whereby they are into a Kunki squad. And I'm sure over 4 or 5 years, you know, they will learn some amount of it, you know, how to drive elephants, how to maneuver their way around. And I think this needs to be done. This needs to be done not only as a human-elephant, you know, conflict mitigation measure, but also to keep the skill set alive. You just can't put a normal 16-year-old kid on an elephant and tell him to go and chase elephants. It's a different ballgame when you go into the field. I have captive elephants. I would definitely like to see captive elephants. No captive elephants. Elephants in the wild are the best thing. Hypothetically, in range states like India, we have use of captive elephants. But now the conservation use of captive elephants bearing the patrolling part on the Kunki part is diminishing. So I think we need to come out with a program where we can recruit new stock into the system. They work with the old stock, and over a period of time, they become effective anti-depredation elephants. That's it. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I don't know how to start it also. I'm tired, actually. I have done so many PILs also. Now the case is in Supreme Court. It's very pathetic. Earlier, in fact, 3 days back, one tusker is killed near Tejpur in the daylight, and the tusk has been removed. And earlier, people used to kill an elephant because of tusk. Now, they are in some places, some tribes, they are killing it for the meat also. They are taking away the whole, earlier the tusk was there, so you don't, other rest of it is there. Now, the whole elephant is taken away. In fact, about 10 years back, in Nagaland, a domestic elephant has been taken there, hired for logging purpose. Then that mahout has come in the Bihu time, festival time for holiday. We usually tie the hind legs and then we release it. That elephant has been eaten away. And there's no trace. Later on, they found the bones also. And here, it is so... Because you are from other country, I should not highlight that. He will know just half a kilometer. In this compound, there are 34 elephants, wild elephants. This is a national... this is a sanctuary. And now, every day, 10 to 15 houses are constructed, department cannot do anything. Until and unless we might talk, we will say, but we don't have power. Department and politicians, if they don't have the intention, we cannot do anything. We NGOs, we cannot do anything. We can say only, who will bell the cat? That is what is the thing here. And last month, I think in Kaziranga, two places, they have evicted in some corridor. And I went 15 days back. I saw there a herd of elephant where this 200 people were there, very small area. And in other place, there are about 8 to 10 rhinos. We don't have to do plantation. We don't. Only we human, if we say, protect the place, the nature will do its own course. Protection is the very much needed. And I went to Manas every year, 4 or 5 times. I go to Bhutan Manas also. Recently, in 15 days back, in Bedbury area, a Royal Bengal tiger has been killed. And it is very bad, and I don't know how to do the things. I have got my captive elephant, I'm keeping it. And the mahouts also. What to do if they keep the other mahouts, they do illegal thing in the forest, they do logging. Otherwise, there's nothing to eat also for them.
Because it was an extempore speech. This man loves elephant and nature from the core of his heart. So he speaks like that. Actually, I am born and brought up here. I am almost 60 now. I have seen the degeneration of this area. Actually, we talk of carrying capacity of a wildlife habitat. Kaziranga has a carrying capacity of, say, 2,000 rhinos or 1,500 rhinos. We do not talk of carrying capacity of our land. How much man this land can actually accommodate? We do not talk of that. This becomes a political issue. So actually, the sentiment Doodle is expressing, I also have. Kaushik, everybody will have these sentiments because we have seen the pristine forest. And it is the wish of Mother Nature that just don't disturb. A forest comes in 5 years. Here, just don't disturb the area. Don't let your cattle to go and graze and you collect firewood. In 5 years, you get a beautiful forest. You have heard of that, Jadav Payeng forest. He just protected some areas and planted some saplings. A beautiful forest has come. Now it is being visited by tigers, rhino and elephant, everything. You know, Orang Rajiv Gandhi Orang National Park, it is a reverse process. Generally, it is the forest cleared by human and, turned into village. Orang was actually some villages and people died of kalajar in 1800th century. So, in no time, that has become a very beautiful forest. Now, there are 100 plus rhinos. There are 30 tigers. While elephant population is also building up. So, the mother nature has given us, but we have not maintained it. So, over 60% of the forest has gone. Almost every reserve forest is gone. So, this just behind our college is the Amchang Wildlife Sanctuary. Amchang Wildlife Sanctuary. Legally, it has a big status, good status. The forest department can cause eviction. But more than 10,000 families have settled there. More than 10,000 families have settled there. Biodiversity is losing very fast. He says the elephants have no place to go. And not only elephants. Elephants are visible, but other species. Tigers was there, has gone. Leopard gone. All small cats are also going. You know, you had porcupine. You had all sorts of, means a very good biodiverse area, but everything we are losing. And so this is the story almost entire India. Assam is a small India, so to say. And we are losing forests. We have allowed the population to grow. And then, so our actually issues are focused in elephant, but around elephant, the whole thing, everything. We had many other issues regarding culling. If there is an excess population, what to do, how to manage the population? Can we go for culling or should we go for birth control? These are options available in our hand. So what, elephants in the zoos, elephant in circuses. So now I open the discussions. So anybody can come. Kaushik wants to say something.
The thing is, you know, everybody is, what Dr. Sharma said, Doodle said, and I'm sure before this, a lot of people said that, you know, about wild elephants. I mean, being captive elephant owners is not that we do not think about wild elephants. I just love elephants in the wild. But what I have seen over the years is, we keep on crying about what is lost and do not do something to retain whatever is left. This should be the principle of elephant conservation. If you are to see elephants in the wild, stop crying over whatever has gone away. Try to protect whatever is there. Enrich it and then think about going beyond it. It's like, you know, you are crying over spilt milk, but there is milk getting burnt out there. So this is one thing that we need to address. And elephant capture. Culling is a no-option option in India. It can never happen. Unless, you know, it's gone, the animal's gone way overboard. It cannot be proclaimed and taken out. But few will agree and few will not. Elephant population has increased sizably in areas where a devastation will take place in years to come. So we might need to take a decision where we selectively pick up or rather harvest individuals so as to stress them out to keep the population down for some time, buy more time for more, like I said, for more scientific actions to come in. This is a touchy topic. Even I do not like capturing elephants, but right now there is no other option than, you know, selectively taking up, you know, harvesting stock. And, we now have more scientific ways of actually, you know, restraining an animal, be it a rhino, an elephant, or a tiger. I think it can be a combination of our age-old methods with chemical immobilization. That would be a more humane way to actually get things going. Thank you.
Thank you. In uniform, sitting here. And he has a lot of experience with elephants because he served in Naringi. It was a part of the Amchang Wildlife Sanctuary. So there are good population of elephants. They have problems. Their go-downs are raided by the elephants. So I would like to listen to them. Yeah.
My experience with elephants has started here itself. In fact, in my last tenure when I was posted here, elephants are very fond of sweets. They are almost like us North Indians in that regard. They cannot just stay away from sweets. Any sweets that they can get, they go there. So sugar godowns are our favorite haunts. And you may lock it, you may bolt it, you may put anything. Unless it's a ditch that the elephant cannot reach with its trunk, it will go. The only way to stop an elephant is the obstacle has to be beyond the reach of its trunk. Anything that it can touch with its trunk, it will go there. Whether it is up, down, across, it will cross it and it will go there. And very wise animals, very gentle beings. And let me assure you, their IQ is almost higher than 50% of the human population. You build a wall, you build a barbed wire fence, it will come very gently to put its leg next to the pole and push it down. And it will walk only across that pole, it will not walk across the barbed wire. It will walk across the pole and it will cross over. You can build any amount of walls, two elephants, the biggest of the herd will come, go onto the pillars, not onto the walls, push the pillars down and the entire herd will walk across. You can do whatever you want, you cannot stop it. The best is to learn to live with them, and they're very social animals. They're so social that at times you feel as if it's one family going to meet the other family. My first exposure was when an elephant calf fell into a storage water tank. We built storage water tanks for firefighting, which are about 225 kiloliters each. They have vertical walls. One of the evenings, a calf fell in. It was nighttime when I got the report. I happened to be the duty officer, so I happened to go to the spot. The entire herd was trying to take out the calf for the last almost hour plus. They were unable. They moved off, allowing humans to approach the calf. A wild herd moved off, allowing us to approach. It took us almost hour and a half to 2 hours. We were required to put in certain bridging girders into that tank so that the calf could stand on that girder and come outside. The calf came out on its own, went back to the herd, and the herd moved off without damaging a single building in the area. So a very wise animal, a very knowledgeable animal, and a very social animal. I also had the experience of having two herds meet. Two separate herds of 20 to 30 animals coming to each other, coming face to face, stopping about 50 feet away. The largest animals going and meeting first, then the entire group mingling, and then the kids playing with each other. And finally, after an hour or two, the two herds moving off in different directions. It's a very wise animal, a very gentle animal. I think we need to understand it more. And we need to study it much more than what we do. Thank you.
That was very good.
We can live or coexist with elephants. Because in Naringi area, elephants are there. Quite often we go and the elephants are just nearby. People don't mind, elephants also don't mind. They are living, coexisting very nicely. Thank you, sir. Anybody else want to express? Yeah, madam.
One is for the gentleman who was talking about raising elephant calves.
Ask your children.
My question to him is the challenge of creating the right formula, is it the same for African elephants? And has there been cross-referencing with, for example, the Sheldrake? Trust in Kenya, which does a lot. And my question...
Huh? Ask, he has just left, so you ask your question to John.
Yes, it mentioned that there was a trial and error in devising the right formula, but there has been a lot of experience in Kenya doing that. So what I'm interested in is, has there been... I can't talk behind me.
He's
looking
at him. He's not
here. Oh, I see. So does anyone have an answer to that?
No, I think...
Is it the same?
I think you asked John's question.
So
actually, there is a message coming from the organizers that lunch is ready.
Yes, okay.
It's getting
so
cold.
John's question, I'm interested.
Yeah, so you have the John's question.
It applies to this last thing. Does the captive elephant have any aspirations in future to going beyond the voluntary into trying to in get regulation by law?
No. as a group, no. It's not. I don't think so. I can look around other members of the group. I think that's something that is not that could be a discussion by certain members of the group, particularly our local colleagues, the people more involved in government, and they could start moving forward. But as a group, particularly because so many of us are international and not from the local countries, albeit some of us have lived there for a long time, we don't see it as our place to do that. But it is something that we would look at advising and helping our colleagues to do. Thank you, Ordon. Robin? Can I see Robin? Robin's name?
You wanted.
Should I conclude?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The vote of thanks was supposed to be proposed by Mr. Mathur. He's around?
I don't think so.
So, who will?
You go ahead.
Yourself?
You go ahead, sir. You're the right man.
Thank you very much. So, I have the honor of proposing vote of thanks to everybody. First of all, I would thank the authority of Assam Agricultural University College of Veterinary Science for allowing us to use these facilities for holding this program, and particularly the Dean Faculty of Veterinary Science, Dr. Raren Goswami. He himself came and delivered the welcome address. My heartiest thanks to him. And of course, Balipara Foundation, Ranjit Ghatakur, Robin, his friend, then Sanjeev Dutta, they are the key people who made it happen. I personally cannot name everybody, but so my heartiest thanks to everybody for your active participation and the way we started, still the hall is full. So that says that people are not bored the way we have handled the program. So thank you very much. Before the lunch gets chilled, thank you very much. Let us pledge that we will all, in our small way, will contribute for the betterment of elephants and betterment of this earth. Thank you very much.